we talk about the tropospheric trace gases. There are three main categories of the tropospheric trace gases. There is the hydroxyl radical. Number two is the reactive nitrogen compounds, and that can be grouped into nitrogen oxides and the nitrate radical. And the third type of tropospheric trace gases is the organic compounds, and this can also be separated into three main organic compounds, or at least the major components of the atmosphere in the category of organic compounds, which are the carbon monoxide gas, the ozone gas, and the sulfur gases. Now we talk about the hydroxyl radical, or also known as the atmospheric detergent because of its cleansing ability in the atmosphere. It's a cleansing ability to remove gases from the atmosphere, or to act as a sink, as a very strong sink. Now the very reactive hydroxyl radical OH can be produced in the troposphere through chemical reactions with the presence of UV light. Now this OH reacts with nitrogen oxides and hydrocarbons in the air to form ozone molecules as well as other pollutants. Now the global and diurnal average values of OH are very small, which is about 3 OH molecules for every 10 to the power of 14 molecules in the air. And this could be due to the very short lifetime of this OH, or the very short residence times of this OH in the atmosphere, which is about 1 second. Like I mentioned before, OH is a main sink of other gases because it is very reactive to all these other gases. Now, OH is produced when ozone is added with photons that comes from the sunlight of a very specific wavelength of less than 0.32 micrometers, or basically UV light. And this reaction will produce oxygen atoms, oxygen molecules with energetically excited oxygen atom, or O star. Now only 1% of this O star react with water vapor to form OH, the air, and that is done through that equation of O star plus H2O to form the two molecules of OH. The main formula, or the combination formula, is that formula shown there, where ozone reacts with water vapor plus the photon to equal the oxygen atom plus the two OH molecules, or the hydroxyl radical molecules. Now you see a diagram here on the bottom right that shows the types of chemicals or gases that can react with hydroxyl molecules. One of it is sulfur dioxide to form dihydrogen sulfate. It also reacts with hydrogen sulfide to form sulfur dioxide. Hydrocarbons will react with hydroxyl to form CO and H2O, and so on. So a lot of these gases in the atmosphere reacts with hydroxyl radical to basically be destroyed by the radical to form another molecule, and that's why it's called a sink. Now there is also the null cycle, where the ozone would form the OH, but then it would reform back to ozone, which means it's a circular cycle. It's a null cycle. Null cycle means that whatever positive value of OH being created, it reverts back to the original state, hence the name null cycle. Now we saw that OH is able to react with many gases in the atmosphere, which makes it less available or less present in the atmosphere. But what are the main gases that reacts with OH? So one of the main gases is carbon monoxide in the atmosphere. It reacts with OH greatly to reduce the amount of OH in the atmosphere, and CO itself would change into carbon dioxide from this reaction. Methane, or CH4, will also react with OH at a large scale compared to other gases, and they would form they would form carbon monoxide and also water vapor. Now over the land masses, or over the continents, the non-methane hydrocarbons, or NMHC, is a very strong local sink of OH, which means that OH will react with these gases vigorously. And an example of an NMHC that is emitted by the forest is the isoprene, or the C5H8, and this is released quite naturally. It's mostly emitted by deciduous trees, or decaduous trees. Now, the role of humans on OH concentration is still unclear, although research is being done on that to understand the effects of humans or human activities on OH concentration. Now, on the right, we see the types of deciduous or decaduous trees that releases isoprene that can react with hydroxyl. Now we go into some reactive nitrogen compounds which can react in the atmosphere with other gases, and the main reactive nitrogen compounds in the atmosphere is the nitrile oxide and the nitrogen dioxide, or NO and NO2. And these two gases play very important roles in atmospheric chemistry. Now, NO and NO2 is emitted by fossil fuel combustion processes, biomass burning processes, soil processes, lightning, ammonia oxidation, aircraft emissions, and even transport from the stratosphere or the layer above the troposphere. Some main reactions of NO and NO2 is on the right. We see that the nitrogen oxide would react with ozone to form nitrogen dioxide and oxygen gas, while nitrogen dioxide would further react with oxygen gas and another inert molecule that absorbs excess molecular energy, or we just say SM as a generic term, under the presence of sunlight, or HF, or the energy of photon, to produce the nitrogen oxide again, this is a cycle or a null cycle, and ozone and that M molecule. Now, this nitrogen dioxide has multiple reaction paths, and this depends on the diurnal trend. So at night, when there is no sun, nitrogen oxides is only nitrogen dioxide. That means the combination of nitrogen oxide is a combination of nitrogen dioxide and nitrogen oxide, but at night, this nitrogen oxide is only in the form of nitrogen dioxide, and this is because of reaction number one. Then residence time of nitrogen dioxide is about 1 day, which is relatively short compared to the other gases. And during the day, this is the reaction where nitrogen dioxide will react with the hydroxyl radical with the inert molecule to form the hydrogen nitrate in the air in vapor form plus that molecule. And this hydrogen nitrate in the residence time is about 1 week. So it's pretty long compared to just the nitrogen dioxide residence time. But during the night, there's a different reaction pathway where nitrogen dioxide will react with ozone to form nitrogen trioxide. And this nitrogen trioxide will react with the nitrogen dioxide to form dinitrogen oxygen, pentaoxide. And that will react with water to form the hydrogen nitrate in the atmosphere. So there's two pathways for nitrogen dioxide, which depends on the time of day or the presence of sunlight. Then the nitrate radical, we've seen that in the reaction for during the day here, or NO3 during the day. OH is the most important oxidant for nitrogen dioxide, but during the night, this nitrogen trioxide becomes the major oxidant because the lack of OH during the day. Now, during the day, the nitrogen NO3 would react with sunlight, or specifically for the wavelength of less than 0.7 micrometer, to form nitrogen oxide with oxygen gas. And then there's also another pathway during the day where the nitrogen trioxide will react with that with sunlight, but at a wavelength of less than 0.58. to form nitrogen dioxide plus an oxygen atom. Now, because it's so reactive, this nitrate radical has only a residence time of 5 seconds, but still not as reactive as OH. Now, the nitrogen NO3 would also react with NO to form nitrogen dioxide. Now, carbon monoxide, or CO. Now, CO is produced by the oxidation of methane and other non-methane hydrocarbons, such as isoprene. Now, there are other sources of carbon monoxide, such as from biomass burning, fossil fuel combustion, and these are anthropogenic or human-related emissions. And CO can be absorbed or can be destroyed from the atmosphere by its reaction with the hydroxyl radical. where it will form the hydrogen atom and carbon dioxide. And hydrogen atom itself is another reactive substance or reactive compound in the atmosphere, or reactive atom in the atmosphere. So carbon monoxide determines the concentration of hydroxyl radical because it is a major OH sink. So it controls the amount of hydroxyl radical there are in the atmosphere, the CO. So the industrial emissions from Southeast Asia regions such as Malaysia releases significant amounts of CO, which means the amount of OH in the atmosphere in around the region, based on the previous argument, which means that the amount of OH in the region is relatively smaller because of the increased CO concentration in the atmosphere in the region. So now we go into ozone. It is produced from the reaction of trace gases, nitrogen oxide, carbon monoxide, and other organic compounds. And this is true photochemical reactions or in the presence of sunlight. Now, ozone is produced by in situ reactions, that means it is produced in the atmosphere, also through the oxidation of carbon monoxide, CH4, NMHC, and NOx by OH. So there is a link between the NMHC and the NOx and their reactions of OH with ozone as well. There's also a null reaction where the ozone produced gets destroyed automatically after it's being produced, hence the name null reaction. And this occurs under the presence of sunlight for the wavelength of less than 0.430 or close to UV spectrum, within the UV spectrum, where the nitrogen dioxide reacts with the photon from the sun to form NO, an oxygen atom. And this oxygen atom would react with an oxygen gas to with another inert molecule to form ozone, and that inert molecule. And ozone would back react with nitrogen oxide to form NO2 and O2. Hence, for any ozone that's created, it gets destroyed back into the original NO2. But there are also other reactions that control ozone formation, or else there is no accumulation of ozone in the atmosphere if it's just up to the null reaction we saw just now. So HOX or hydrogen oxides and other organic species can also create ozone. So OH plus CO, or hydroxyl radical plus carbon monoxide, can form H and carbon dioxide, and that H and that and oxygen would react with inert molecule to form HO2 plus the inert molecule. Now, in the absence of nitrogen oxide and in sunlight, this HO2 that's produced from the previous reaction would react with ozone to form O2 and OH. And the two H2O2 would form a hydrogen peroxide, or H2O2, and oxygen gas. And that OH will plus the NO2 plus M to form the hydrogen nitrate plus M. Now, this H2O2 and the HNO3 are very soluble in water, and they can be quickly removed from the atmosphere through wet deposition. But under very high NO conditions, the OH would react with CO plus O2 to form HO2, just like before, and but with carbon dioxide. And this HO2 plus the NO to form OH and NO2, and this NO2 would react with the sunlight or photon to form NO and O. So that O, the oxygen atom, would react with oxygen gas plus with the inert molecule M to form ozone plus that M, which makes NO converts to NO2 without using O3, hence the accumulation of ozone without because of that NO being able to convert to NO2, unlike the first pathway. So this gives another pathway for ozone to accumulate into the atmosphere, but under high NO conditions. Now there's the sulfur gases. The major sulfur gases in the atmosphere are sulfur dioxide, hydrogen sulfide, dimethyl sulfide, CH3, SCH3, or in short, DMS. And then there's the COS and carbon disulfide, or CS2. Oxidized sulfur gases are removed from the atmosphere through wet deposition because they are water soluble. So that is a major sink for these sulfur gases. And the natural sources of sulfur dioxide is through this reaction pathway where hydroxyl radical again will react with hydrogen sulfide, and hydrogen sulfide, one of the emitters of this gas, is from the ocean, to form water and HS. So HS would form would react with ozone to form HSO plus O2, and that HS will also react with nitrogen dioxide to form HSO plus NO, and HSO plus ozone would react to become HSO2 plus O2 and HSO2 plus O2 would become HO2 plus sulfur dioxide, and that's where how sulfur dioxide gets created from the atmosphere from the chemical H2S as well as the hydroxyl radical and other oxidative compounds in the atmosphere. Now, fossil fuel combustion, volcanoes, and biomass burning are also sources of sulfur dioxide. Sources of H2S, which is a precursor of SO2, are from soils, marshlands, oceans, which is a big component, and also volcanoes. The oceanic sources are very large sources of sulfur gases, and these gases are released from the ocean due to biological reactions in the ocean, specifically the phytoplankton biological activities. And these biological activities would emit sulfur gases, and one example is the dimethyl sulfide, or DMS. Now, this DMS reacts with the hydroxyl radical to again produce SO2, just like how H2S reacts with hydroxyl radical to form SO2.